So we are on soteriology, part two. Excuse me. And we're going to look at the aspects of salvation. We're going to kind of be looking at terminology, a lot of terminology that we hear in theological circles, that we may hear in church. So we're going to kind of go over some of these words. Some of them may be familiar to you. Some of them may not be familiar to you. But we are going to start just looking at what we call the aspects of salvation. And the three primary aspects of salvation we're going to look at here: justification, sanctification, glorification. You can... We talk about it as sort of the three arms of salvation, okay? Justification, we are saved. Sanctification, we are being saved. And then glorification is we will be saved. And if you remember last week, we talked about salvation. Soteriology, sozo, soteria, means deliverance or salvation. So, you know, we are, our salvation is three-pronged. We have justification, and we're going to go into each one of these things in greater depth, but just as an introduction. Justification is the moment of our salvation, that we are delivered. It's a positional truth. The next step is sanctification, which is the process of our being delivered, the process of our being saved, which sounds strange, but in 1 Corinthians 1:18, it talks about the preaching is foolishness to those who are perishing, but it is the power of the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. It was a lot simpler than I thought. The power of God. And in the view of King James, it probably just says, for those who are saved. But in the original language, it actually is saying, it's a participle. Those who are being saved, which is us. Those of us in the room who know Jesus Christ as our Savior. We are saved, but we are also being saved. And then finally, glorification is what will happen either at the rapture or at the end of our life. We are brought into the presence of God and we are ultimately saved. You may also hear this word in the term sanctification, that we are sanctified, we are being sanctified, or we have positional sanctification. We have progressive sanctification. Because sanctification has the same idea. Sanctification means set aside, separated, to be made holy. So we have positional sanctification, progressive sanctification, and then what's called ultimate sanctification.
Now, can you tie that in with the Trinity? Like justification would be through Jesus, sanctification through the Holy Spirit, and then glorification.
Well, in a sense, yeah, sure. I mean, justification is through the cross. Sanctification is through the power of the Holy Spirit. And glorification is will be in the presence of the Father. Yeah. So I never thought of that before, but that's, I like that. That's good. So, first we're going to look at justification. Okay. The Greek word is dikaiō. Comes from dike in the Greek. And dike in the Greek just means right. that which is right. So, dikaiō speaks of being made right, being made righteous. Turn to 2 Corinthians 5:21. This is a verse I'm sure we're all familiar with. Made him who knew no sin to be sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God. And that's where, when you see the word justification or righteous or righteousness or justified, it's all the same word in the Greek. It's the exact same word. It's all just depending on the application. So, you know, he made us to be righteous, the righteousness of God. And that's what justification is. You know, it is. That's why I gave you guys that sheet last week with the 33 things that happen in salvation, because and again, it's arbitrary how many things there actually are. That's not from the Bible. But this is what happens at the moment of salvation. This is what justification is. And all those things are part of justification. It's all about our being placed in a new position, becoming heirs of the kingdom, and all these other things that you'll see on that list. It is the thing that happened at that moment in time that we were made righteous. You know, acquitted of all our sin, past, present, and future. You know, and there are those who hold to this idea that it cleanses us from sins in the past, but everything we do from salvation on is another story. And that's not the case.
That's true, we're in big trouble.
Yeah, that's true, we're all in big trouble. You know, the sacrifice of Christ on the cross shoots in both directions. You know, first of all, to all the Old Testament saints, it is applied to those who believed through faith. And then it is shot forward to all those who will believe someday. And if that's the case, it also applies to all our sins, past, present, and future. Now, justification does not make us righteous, because when I look at my life and I look in the mirror, I don't say, now there's a righteous guy. I know my heart, and I know the things that I do and the things that I think. And I know that I am not, in my experience, in my present condition, I am not righteous. Justification is a legal declaration. It is, we are declared righteous. We have legal standing. It's almost like, you know, you win a court case, and the jury, the judge, or whoever awards you $1 million from, you know, whoever it is that you might be suing, let's just say, and he awards it to you. That doesn't mean you're going to get it right away. It's yours. It legally is. You have rights to it and everything, but it may take time for the process. Happen. And that's kind of where we are as we walk on this earth. We have, and there's more that goes on than that. We're going to get to that when we get to sanctification. But as far as justification, it is a declaration of a legal standing. And because of that, because God does not exist in time, you know, God doesn't look at us the way we are right now. He looks at us, he looks at the finished product. You know, he looks at who we are going to be. It's like, you know, when I say the name Scrooge, everybody thinks some miserly, old, miserable, penny-pinching, nasty guy. Well, but that's not how the book ends. That's not how he is in the end. In the end, he's a great guy. You know, it says there was never a greater man than walked the city. And it's like God looks at the end of the book, because that is what has been declared. That is what has been written in the book. And so that's how God sees us. So God sees us as having Christ's perfect righteousness. Not personal righteousness, but it has been put to our account. It's been put in the bank for us. Almost like a trust fund. It's there, it's ours, and someday we're going to be able to have all of it. Turn of Rome is 320. It's important for us to understand how this happens. And the Romans is the best place to do that. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. You know, we are not justified by works. The law plays a role. It says that it was our school teacher. It schooled us. It taught us what the law was so that we could recognize our own sin. Because if I don't know the law, then how do I know if I'm breaking it? You know? Once I know the law, then I realize, oh, the law doesn't make me a sinner. It just helps me to recognize my sinful condition. So the law is good. You know, we never want to say, oh, we're not law Christians. We're not into the law. I'm way into the law. The law of God is good. The scripture tells us that. Scripture tells us that the law of the Lord is good. It's for our benefit. We're just not held to it as a standard because we can't live up to it. That's really the point, is that we cannot live up to it, and that it shows us the need for grace. You know, Romans 3:24, just go a few more verses. Where are we? Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. You know, this is why it's important for us to realize that the law brings us to that point where we realize we need God's grace. And I'm sure I've mentioned this in class. Kirk Cameron and Ray Comfort, they do the Way of the Master. Have you guys ever seen the Way of the Master, whether it's their TV show or their videos or whatever? And their whole thing is, They start going through the Ten Commandments with people. You know, have you ever lied? Have you ever, looked upon a woman with lust? Have you ever blasphemed the name of God? And they kind of go through different things. And some people look at that, man, they're giving people the law. No, what they're doing, the way they describe it is, if you sit down with your doctor and he says, here, I want you to take this medicine. It's going to save your life. And you say, well, why am I taking this medicine? It's great medicine. It's an amazing medicine. It's going to save your life. You're going to be like, well, why do I need to take the medicine? Just because it's wonderful medicine. You should take it. No, the doctor would sit you down and say, look, you've got a problem. You've got a blood disease. Left unattended, this blood disease is going to kill you. But we've got this medicine. And this medicine will reverse that blood disease. Now you're like, give me the medicine. Well, we give people, we don't necessarily have to use the Ten Commandments like Ray Comfort does, but we want people to be convinced of their sinful condition. And that's what happens with us at the point of salvation. We have to become aware of our sinful condition, and the law does that. But we have to understand that's not what saves us. There are a lot of people, I've talked to a lot of people who understand that they're sinners, and they, oh, I know, I'm probably going to hell. Not much I can do about it. No, wait a minute, I want to give you the message of grace, and they can still reject it. But we have to come to that place first, and then we are saved by grace. Now, I want to look at, there's a couple of, just our justification is based on two things. Propitiation and expiation. Okay? Propitiation is satisfying God's justice. God is a just God. God says, the soul that sins shall surely die. God said that the wages of sin is death. So, God is just, and God's justice has to be satisfied. He loves us, but he can't just wink at sin. That justice has to be satisfied. Jesus Christ's death at the cross satisfied God's justice. One of the other translations of this word, and it's katalasso. I'm sorry, the other one is katalasso. Hilasterio. Different word, isn't it? It's worse than propitiation. Hilasterion in the Greek is sometimes translated as the mercy seat. The mercy seat was the lid on the ark. That's where the blood was sprinkled. That's what's satisfying. When God sees the blood, then his justice is satisfied. The wages of sin is death. Well, the one man who never sinned died for sin. So my justice is satisfied. But that's not enough. Okay? The other part is, this is a word that most people have never heard of, is expiation. Because you're not, this one you're not going to find in the Bible. It's a two-pronged process. There is God's justice being satisfied, but there is also the removal of our sin and the imputation of Christ's righteousness. Okay, now, actually Tony and I were talking about this, was it yesterday? Yeah, yesterday afternoon. Well, which comes first? And neither one really logically or chronologically comes first, because in order for our sins to be removed, God's justice has to be satisfied. But God's justice is satisfied in the removal of our sin. So it's just a sort of a two-pronged process that has to happen as part of justification. In order for us to be fully justified, you know, God's justice must be satisfied and our sin must be removed. So, now another way of looking at this is what's called atonement. This is the one that was, katalage is actually the Greek, atonement, which means basically reconciliation. It's really part of the whole process. It is the coming together of God and man through this process. Now, atonement in the New Testament is different than atonement in the Old Testament. Atonement in the Old Testament is the word kafar. I'm sure I mispronounced it. Kafar, okay. Which is basically a covering. You know, it's a covering of something. It's like a sealing. So that it's not seen. Because in the Old Testament, there was salvation, but the price for sin hadn't been paid. The sins had not actually been removed, because that was coming with the cross. So the faith, the people acting, in, you know, whether it's through the sacrifices or just through faith, those sacrifices and those acts of faith covered their sin temporarily, if you will, until the sin was dealt with. So it was a covering. It was not a removal of the sin. Whereas in the New Testament, I always say this because there's two different words in the Old Testament and the New Testament. So these words have different meanings in the original language. You know, we sort of use the same word in both testaments because it, you know, the net result is the same, that this covering is what allowed people to, you know, to be reconciled to God, but it was different because it was not the removal of sin. In New Testament, this is the removal of sin. Our sins being forgiven. Sin is being taken out of the way, not just covered.
So all three are the same thing, basically.
Yeah, well, it's all part of justification. I mean, the two arms of justification is that first, I only say first because I'm saying it first, but that our sins have to be removed. Our sins have to be taken out of the way, and then we have to be, but that's not enough. Because if our sins are just removed, then we are left at zero. And that's not enough to get into heaven. We must now have the righteousness of Christ imputed into us. So that when God looks at us, he is looking at the righteousness that, you know, it's like we have a great debt. We owed $1 million. No way we could pay it. And God just says, forget it. You know, we're going to wipe away that debt. Well, it's more than that. It's more than wiping away the debt. through Christ's sacrifice, we're not just left with a bank account that says zero. We're left with a bank account that now says $1 million. You know, that's like the two, you know, the difference between grace and mercy. Mercy is us not getting what we deserve. Grace is us getting what we do not deserve. So, you know, mercy brings us to zero. Expiation brings us to zero. But we must be fully justified through Christ's righteousness being imputed into us, so that it is put to our account.
What's wrong with zero if, according to the Bible, if someone were theoretically perfect, they could be right to enter heaven?
Because you still, it's zero does not mean you're righteous. Zero just means that your sins are forgiven. It's like when we talked about the, you know, the bullseye. Okay, we are in our state, we are here, probably more like, you know, out here. But, you know, we've missed the mark. If I erase that doesn't put anything to my account. Okay, if I just erase that, what has to happen is I have to be moved onto this position to become righteousness. I mean, to become righteous. I mean, you know, some of these things are difficult to understand, difficult to explain.
Is that the imputation?
That's the imputation. It's like, you know, when it says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. You know, it's not, you know, I separate it out, but it's all part of one process. One can't happen without the other. It's not, and I'm separating it out for the purpose of explanation, but it's not like you can be made zero without receiving the righteousness of Christ.
I always look at it as though when Christ died, that's forgiveness of sins and justification, but righteousness when he was resurrected. Am I right about that?
You can look at it that way, but it gets confusing only because of the chronology, you know, that we are, our place in heaven was only guaranteed by his resurrection, because he has to be the forerunner of eternal life. And if he's not raised, then we're not saved. You know, so it is true, but it's, you know, we can look at it and say, like, it's two different events, but it's still the same event in God's eyes, because there's 3 days in the grave.
We're placed into the risen Christ.
Yeah.
We're buried with them.
Yeah, and we're raised with them.
Raised with them in the risen Christ.
Yeah.
Therefore, we're righteous. It's all
yeah, separate. But again, it's because remember, you know, God is looking down at it as one event. You know, with our minds, we can look at that and think that there was sort of 3 days, you know, where, you know, where salvation wasn't really being affected. But as far as God was concerned, Christ's death, burial, and resurrection is all one event. You know, because God does not exist in time, so, and he knew it was going to happen. It wasn't like God was sitting up there biting his nail. Is he going to raise? Is he going to, you know? I mean, it wasn't an issue for God. As far as he was concerned, it had already happened, so it was done. That's why the Old Testament saints could be saved, because he knew what was going to happen. You know, that's why salvation could exist in the Old Testament.
I know it's just all terminology, and we all use the same terminology, but I like to think of it as our sins were paid for, not necessarily forgiven, because God can't, Jesus paid for our sins for us. The way I look at it, they were paid for, he took the sin upon himself and washed us clean, and in that respect, yeah, we're forgiven, but I think from God's point of view, he can't forgive sin. You know, God can't forgive sin because sin is so abhorrent to him that it just, and he can't take it away. He can't let us off with a free ride and say that's okay because he's so holy. But somebody had to pay that price.
Well, it was, he can forgive, but only if his justice is satisfied.
Right.
That's what we talked about last week about, you know, mercy and truth are met together, righteousness and peace have kissed each other. these two seemingly at odds positions, God has managed to reconcile and bring them together because he loves us. He wants to be merciful, but he is prevented by his own righteousness.
Right.
Well, if my righteousness is satisfied, if sin is no longer an issue, now I can forgive him. Because, yeah, you can't just wink at it and say, oh, I forgive you. You know, we struggle with it, but we should just forget about it. You know, we don't need to ask people to satisfy our justice if they sinned against us, because reality is their sin was always against God anyway, and who are we not to forgive? So our forgiveness is very different from God's forgiveness, because God has every right not to forgive, you know, because he's God. But he wanted to forgive, but in order to bring himself to be able to forgive, he had to satisfy his justice through Christ's death on the cross.
I believe they are taking away the scapegoat. The goat is taken out in the wilderness and thrown off a cliff.
Yeah.
The same as our sins are tossed into the deepest ocean. That's a Micah.
Yeah.
So actually, as far as God's concerned, we never sin.
Yeah.
Because Christ did it all.
Yeah.
Is that what Grace described in the term redeemed? The term redeemed?
Well, bought back. Redeemed is being bought back. And that's also part of the definition of atonement, is being bought back, is being brought together again. And again, it's that reconciliation, a ransom that is paid, is part of the definition of atonement, is that there was a ransom paid to, you know, you think of somebody who's been kidnapped. The people have been separated by this event, and then a ransom has been paid to bring them together.
At one moment.
And you've ever heard justification, another way to remember that is just as if I'd never sinned. So, you know, in Zechariah 3, and this, here's a beautiful picture of salvation. Zechariah 3, 1 through 7, Satan was accusing Joshua the high priest, because the high priest had dirty garments. And he did. And he knew he did. Satan was right. Satan was telling the truth, if you will, that Joshua had dirty garments, that Joshua was to be blamed, because the high priest was never to have dirty garments. He always had to have clean garments on.
In Hebrew, that's excrement.
Yeah.
Covered with excrement.
And so what did God do? God said, okay, wait a minute. And he took him aside, he took off his dirty garments, and he put on a clean garment, and then he turned to Satan and said, okay, now accuse him. You know, that is the picture of our salvation. We were covered with what Bob said, with human excrement, if you will. We were covered in sin, and Satan is accusing, and Satan's right. You can't let them into heaven. They've sinned. You know, theoretically, he was right. But God takes us aside and robes us in Christ's righteousness, and then says, okay, now accuse them. See, Satan's accusations now are always lies. Because he can't accuse us of sin if Christ has already paid for it, if we're enrobed in Christ's righteousness. So, you know, and this goes to what we were talking about last week about being born again, the newness of life, regeneration. And it's not on our own merit. Joshua did nothing. Joshua stood there saying, I know, I'm wrong. I am to be accused. I am, you know, the accusation is accurate. He didn't go and make himself a new garment. God gave him the new garment. It was all from God. You know, it is not, the definition of grace, charis, in the Greek, is unmerited favor. It goes right along with agape love. Agape love means I love you because of me, not because of you. I don't love you because you've done something amazing that I like. I don't love you because there's something about you that I'm attracted to. I love you because I choose to love you. Grace is, it's unmerited. I give it to you because I want to give it to you. You know, we can refuse it, and we're going to get to that in a minute. But it is offered freely. So, sanctification. we're going to keep moving along here. Ephesians 4. This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God, because the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feelings have given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. But you have not so learned Christ. If indeed you have heard him, and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God, in true righteousness and holiness. So this is the process. Okay? We are saved, we are being saved. We are now we're going from imputed righteousness to what's called imparted righteousness. Now, it's not just that our, you know, again, we can go back to that trust fund, but it's almost like an annuity. You know, we get a little bit. It's ours. Nobody can take it from us. We're just not getting it all at once. We're going to get a little bit at a time. A little bit at a time. And it is still by God's grace. It is still all by, through God. We are not earning it. We're not, it's not by our own power, but it is by submission. It is by yielding control to the Holy Spirit that he can then impart this experiential righteousness, if you will, that we can, after a period of time of walking with Christ, we can look back and say, wow, I'm not like that anymore. One of the examples I give a lot is in my own personal experience. How many here have seen Good Will Hunting? And I'm willing to admit it. it was a good movie, but a lot of profanity in that movie, right? I mean, just wow. I got news for you. That's how people from South Boston talk. You know, that's, you know, you guys know Bostonian. That is just, and I'm from Boston, and I used to talk like that, you know. And that's how my whole family talks, just the bombs left and right, and JC this, and GD that, and, you know, the words flying around like it doesn't even matter.
Philadelphia is the same way.
Yeah. But that's you know, where I grew up, that was just the way you talk. So that's the way I spoke. Not so much, as I shared before, not so much right when I got saved, but about 2 years later, after I really kind of came back to God and, you know, started reading the Bible and God really got a hold of my heart, I noticed after about a year after, it might not have even been that long, I think I might have only been about 6 months, I was like, what happened to my swearing? You know, there was one day there was a word that came to my lips and I stopped. And it was like, ew. It was something in me that just said, and it was grieved by even hearing it in my head. And I'm like, when did that happen? When did the lip flowing freely change to me being disgusted, even having it in my head? And I don't know. All I know was it was a period of me just yielding to God, being hungry after God, drawing closer to God, that God made the change. And that's what the process is. If you try to fix yourself, if you try to make yourself better, even as a Christian, even with the best intentions, I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm just not going to do it anymore. I'm going to stop doing that. Don't. You know, we shared this last week in Galatians. You know, we walk in the Spirit that we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We don't try not to fulfill the lust of the flesh. Galatians 5:16. That's our walk. Okay. Justification has to do with standing. This is where we stand. Sanctification has to do with ongoing growth. Progressive has to do with character, and it has to do with conduct. But again, it's entirely by grace. It is not something that we produce. It is what the Holy Spirit does in this. In Colossians 2:6, he said, as you have received Christ, so walk in him. It's not like all through Galatians, Paul is telling them, what happened to you guys? Who lied to you? How were you bewitched? How were you tricked into thinking that somehow you are saved by the Spirit, but then somehow you have to walk in works? And the works are the natural byproduct of a walk of faith. We, you know, and I think we've shared this before, trees don't try to bear fruit. You just make the tree healthy. Right, Mark? Mark's our resident.
As far as I can tell.
Mark's our resident husbandman of plant. There's not a lot of fruit trees out there. We have vegetables and all kinds of things. But you do the right things, you make the thing healthy, and you're going to get fruit. They don't sit there and try and, you know, and by their own will try to make the fruit come out. The key is make it healthy. So what we do is we focus on how can I be healthy with God? I can be healthy with God by being in his word, by being taught by someone who puts the time in to, you know, to prepare and study, in prayer, in fellowship, you know, in doing things like this, in furthering our own discipleship and doing everything we can to be around the word and be around God. And, you know, it's what I call being where God is. You know, we all have lives, and some of us have busier lives than others, and sometimes we can't do this and we can't do that. I had a period in my life where my work just took me from church all the time. And I finally realized, well, if I can't, you know, if I can't be there on the days that are typically, you know, church days, then I just gotta go where God is. If there's something going on at the church, I'm gonna be there. I can't make it to Sunday mornings or Wednesday nights, then I'm gonna make it to whatever the Bible study I can make it to, whatever home fellowship I can go to. You know, the church I was in at that time, we had what was called RAPS. You know, some of you might remember the old 60s RAP sessions. That's basically what it was. It was a time after church, or sometimes they do it at lunch, where somebody would get up and, you know, they'd have a pastor get up and share a couple of words, and then everybody would get up and start sort of, you know, throwing their two cents in, if you will, almost like a home fellowship. Everybody sort of adding to it. And that's what I did. I couldn't make it to services, so I went to the RAP sessions. I just tried everything I could do. I just tried to get around the things of God. And when we do that, that's sanctification. That, because what that is, sanctification, hagios in the Greek, is set apart. You know, you set yourself apart. You say, look, I could be home doing this, but this is not going to add to my life. This is not going to add to my spirituality. I'm going to do something different. I'm going to set myself apart. One of the applications for that sort of that mentality of set apart is, I think this crowd is old enough to remember, how many here, their mother had dishes that you never ate off of? Right? See, the young guy doesn't get it.
Plastic covering on seats.
Yeah, the plastic covering on the seats and the, you know. But yeah, my mother had these dishes, and they were dishes for eating. And we did use them once in a while. So very special occasions. Is that?
My wife has still got those.
Yeah. Yeah, they passed along, and then they still don't get used by the next generation. That, you know, in a way, that is sanctification. It's set apart for something special. You know, because we all did. Well, Mom, why don't we use those? Oh, those are for special occasions. They're special. We don't use them just for everyday stuff. See, that's, you know, as believers, we are not profane. And the word profane is, in the Greek, koinonia. Does that sound familiar?
Yeah.
Fellowship. It means common, is what koinonia means. It means common. It has the connotation of fellowship, because we're all here in fellowship, because we all have one thing in common. We have the Holy Spirit. But it also means profane, or common, ordinary. We are not profane. We're not ordinary, and we shouldn't act like we're ordinary. We don't live our lives like, you know, we're just reading in Ephesians. You know, you were once like that. You used to do these things. You don't do these things anymore. That's not you anymore. You're not ordinary. You're not profane. You're special. You're to be used for special reasons by God. So we are sanctified. We are set apart. You know, but still, by grace through faith. Romans 1:17, it says we grow from faith to faith. I still have to turn this thing. I'll leave that up there for us so you guys can get those verses down. So that is sanctification. Now we move on to glorification. We shall be saved. Okay? Justification, we were saved from the penalty of sin. This is important. Justification, we are saved from the penalty of sin. We will never have to pay for our sins. Sanctification, we are saved from the power of sin. We no longer have to live in our sin. You know, we still have to deal with it because we have our old sin nature, but we are no longer like these, like we were, where that was our only choice. Now we don't have to live under the power of sin. So justification, we are free from the penalty of sin. Sanctification, we are free from the power of sin. In glorification, we are freed from the very presence of sin. What a great day that's going to be, isn't it? Where we just don't have to deal with our old sin nature and fight with that part of us because, you know, we're in a place now where we don't want to be like that. We're like Paul. Boy, the things that I don't want to do, I do. The things that I do want to do, I don't do. Who will deliver me from this body of death? Well, we'll be delivered from that body of death when we're delivered from this body of death. You know, when we are in the presence of God and we are being in the presence of God, there is no sin because sin cannot be in His presence. You know, we will become personally perfect and free from all sin. Has everybody got this? Move on so you can get those ones on sanctification. So we'll get caught up. In Romans 13:11, it says, our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. And if you don't understand this, that sounds like a very strange thing to say. I said, our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. I thought I was saved. Well, you are. Well, I thought I was being saved. Well, you are. But there's also a salvation that is coming. And it is, you know, the longer we live, the more we walk with Him, the nearer it is, the closer it is. In glorification, it's going to be revealed who we really are. That person that God has been seeing since the day we got saved, that person that God sees, that's what's going to be revealed, and that is what we're going to see. In 1 John 3:2, it says, we will be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. So, salvation is God's great gift to man. We really can't, you know, we sit here and we delineate and we separate and we get all these terminologies to help us to understand some of the aspects of salvation, but we really can't separate them. I mean, it really is all part of one salvation that begins here and is finalized here, but it's one, you know, act as God sees it. Just like I said, with all those things, those 33 things that happen in a moment, that become reality in a moment. And because God, again, sees the end from the beginning and doesn't, you know, He sees the whole. One of the illustrations that we've heard Pastor Bill give often is like being on the, you know, 15th floor of a building or the 20th floor of a building and watching a parade. We see the whole parade from beginning to end. You know, and that's how God sees, you know, what we see is if we're on the sidewalk watching the parade go by. That's time. But in eternity, He is seeing the beginning from the end. So for Him, it's one event. It's one whole thing. Glorification. Now, we're going to delve into an area that becomes very controversial And I'm sorry to tell you, I'm not going to reconcile this for anybody tonight. You know, this goes along with the Trinity. It's one of those things we teach. It's one of these things that we know is, but we, you know what, we're going to wrestle with the concept of this for a very long time. All we can do is understand what the Bible says. Okay? Election, predestination, and foreknowledge is a balance of God's work and man's will. God is sovereign. God will do what he will do. But we have free will. We are elected. We are part of God's elect. John 15:16, Jesus said, I have chosen you. Ephesians 1, 4, and 5 says, we are adopted according to his will. So we are elected. Predestination is, you know, is everybody done with this? Are we still working on it? We can get some of these up there. We can get some of these things. Okay, predestination, Romans 8, 29 to 30. Let's turn there and we'll read that. And again, we have probably heard, if you've been in the church any length of time, we have heard these things. Romans 8, 29. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. There is predestination. You know, there are those who have a different view of it, that have a very severe view of predestination. But predestination is clearly in the Bible. That God has foreordained certain things. The thing to remember, and the important thing about predestination is that it's less about something that God chose, and more about what he did, in that salvation is all of God and not of ourselves. Okay? And in that way, he predestines us. He sets things in motion beforehand. That, but here's the important thing, and while we have it last here, it comes first in that verse, foreknowledge. Foreknowledge precedes election. Romans 8, it says, starts right off, whom he did foreknow. He predestined. Whom he foreknew what? Would believe. Exactly. And that's where the sort of the meeting of man's will and God's sovereignty, God's choosing. Jesus said, many are called, few were chosen. You know, he called us, but the call is universal. Those who are chosen are few. And he chooses those who choose him. But the process, as we've shared here before, the process starts with him. It's sort of this thing that is often called the divine romance, you know, where, or the sacred romance, where he woos us. He calls us. Jesus said, I will draw all men unto me. No man comes unto the Father unless, no man comes to me unless the Father draws him. See, God initiates the process of drawing us, of calling us, of wooing us, of sending his Spirit to work in our lives, to draw us to him, to make us aware of our sin, you know, convicting the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. And then we turn and respond to that initiation. Okay, but that turning and responding to the initiation is not what saves us. What saves us is the hand of God reaching down and grabbing us because of our the choice that we made, and choosing and faith are not a work. And this is where, you know, the crowd that for the sake of our discussion here today, we're just gonna say on this end we've got Calvinism. On this end we have Arminianism. Okay? And while the gap between here is very, very small, in reality, the gap is enormous between the two. Now, there are those that say, well, I'm not a full Calvinist, I'm a modern Calvinist, I'm a this Calvin. Let's just call, for today's sake, we're going to call a spade a spade. You know, this Calvinism. And when I talk about Calvinism, how many of you have heard of the 5 points of Calvinism? Most of you have heard it, right? Tulip. Okay, you guys probably have also heard of Tulip. This is how you remember the 5 points of Calvinism. Okay? Total depravity. Okay, this is not what we talked about last week. Was it last week? No, 2 weeks ago. We talked about man and sin. We talked about us being totally depraved. That, in that context, I'm just talking about how our sin permeates every part of our being. When they talk about total depravity, they say our sin permeated our whole being to the point where we no longer even have a free will. That we cannot choose God. We don't have the ability to even positively respond to the initiation of God. That in the Calvinistic viewpoint, God must regenerate us first before we can be converted. Before we can get saved, God has to regenerate us. In other words, God has to sort of save us before we can get saved. Because we can't, unless He regenerates us and fixes us, we cannot even choose Him. So we've got total depravity. We've got... unconditional election. Okay? On the surface, that sounds fine. Unconditional election. We are chosen unconditionally. But their idea of election is very different. Their idea of election, the Calvinistic viewpoint of election, is the first thing God did before He even created man, before He even thought of creating man, is, which kind of sounds strange because how would He even think of this until He's thought about creating man? But in their viewpoint, first thing God did was He said, okay, I am going to choose some people, I'm going to create some people for heaven, and I'm going to create some people for hell. Now, I'm going to go ahead and create them. So, when they talk about unconditional election, that's the Calvinistic viewpoint of election. Is that God chooses some people before, the first thing He did out of the gate was choose some people for heaven and appoint some people for hell. Okay? Limited atonement. Limited atonement says just that. Not everybody can get saved. God saying, I have only chosen certain people. I have only chosen the elect to be saved. Those people that, right out of the gate that I chose, those are the only people that can be saved. It's a limited atonement. That when Jesus said, God so loved the world, that He meant the world of the elect, not the whole world. Okay. So that's the limited atonement. Irresistible grace. Well, this goes along with total depravity because we can't even choose positively. We can't even mold our will to the point where we can desire after God, or that we can even, our mind can logically see the sin that we possess and say, I need something more. We don't even have that capability. So God's grace is presented to us, and we cannot refuse it. Once God initiates, once God displays his grace to us, then we cannot refuse it. We have to, we are drawn into it without even our will. Am I right? Perseverance of the saints. And that just means, and again, on the surface, that doesn't sound like a bad thing. Okay? It means because salvation is all of God, there's nothing that I can do to undo that. And I don't have a problem with that. I really don't. But again, their view of it is based on all this. It's based on the fact that, of course, there's nothing I can do about it because I was dragged along the whole way. I had no choice in the matter.
Got a question, Rick.
Sure.
Calvinism.
Calvinism.
Yeah.
And again, for the sake of this, I know some people say there's gradations of Calvinism, et cetera, et cetera. Oh, I'm a three-point Calvinist. Well, Calvinism has 5 points to it. You know, my take is, if you take some of these, if you say, look, I'm good with unconditional election, I'm okay with perseverance of the saints, I'm sort of there with total depravity, but these two, I don't want anything to do with. You know, well, technically speaking, you're not a Calvinist then. You know, that's not Calvinism. Calvinism is 5 points. You know, it's part of what the belief system is. Now, if somebody wants to, that's fine. That's what I'm saying. For the sake of this class, we're just going to sort of Calvinism, and we're going to get to Arminianism in a second.
Ephesians 2:8-9.
Mm-hmm.
For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Arminian or is it Calvinist?
Neither.
Okay.
Because that we are saved by grace. Absolutely, we are saved by grace. But that grace is not irresistible. That, you know, there is the balance of our free will. We still have a free will. Where's that? Hold on a second. Because here's the thing. And don't worry, I'm going to get to Arminians in a second. Okay? And Titus 2:1, it says, for the grace of God appeared saving for all men. I'm just trying to see where he sort of did a literal translation here. Well, let's just turn there real quick. Titus 2:11. Titus 2:11. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Now, if that's true, if the grace of God has appeared to all men, and grace is irresistible, then all men would be saved. Calvinistic viewpoint is, well, that all that means is that the grace of God has appeared to all the elect men. That's the Calvinistic viewpoint. But that's what that means. You know, and that's kind of where they go. Whenever it says all, they say, well, it means all the elect. Well, the word is pas, which means all, and the word man is anthropos, which means mankind. So, all mankind. The grace of God has appeared to all mankind. God has demonstrated his grace in some fashion, whether it's through the testimony of nature, God's provision that we have all around us, the air that we breathe, the sun that shines on us, you know, that's all part of God's grace. And God's grace has appeared to all men. If grace is irresistible, then all men would be saved. And we know that not all men are saved. So, since I don't see irresistible grace in the Bible, then I'm going to side with the Bible saying that the grace of God has appeared to all men. And I know all men are not saved. So, we are saved by grace, but it is, and it's not that we play a part in that we somehow earn it or work toward it, but we play a part in that recognize our need for.
Recognize and respond.
Yeah, recognize and respond. If we don't, we can see God's grace, we can be offered God's grace and say, I don't want any part of it. You know, so.
Wouldn't that be a lack of understanding? I mean,
well, and here's what
he pursues. Well, here's where I'm. Mind, he is going to be met.
Yeah, here's where I'm gonna be fair. The argument that the Calvinists are trying to make is, look, we know, you know, they're trying to bring glory to God and say, we don't want to share any of God's glory. We don't want to we know that we don't play any part in our salvation. And in one sense, that is absolutely true. We can turn to God and cry out to God all we want, and in reality, God can say no. I mean, theoretically, now God never does say no, praise God. You know, he never does because he is, you know, he has said, if any man believes in, you know, if you call on Jesus Christ, you will be saved. So the promise is that if we will believe, that gift of salvation is offered to all who will believe. But the reality is, the theoretical or hypothetical reality is, he's God. He said, I'll have mercy on whom I'll have mercy. And theoretically, we could turn to him and say, God save me. He says, no. Now, God would not do that. And this kind of goes back to God's attributes. Because God is just, because he has done everything and has satisfied his justice, it makes no sense. He came down to die on a cross to say no. So he wouldn't. But I'm just saying, if we look at, you know, God certainly would have the right to refuse salvation. So our turning to him and calling out to him is not what saves us. It is his gracious hand reaching down to us that saves us. But God will not impose himself on somebody. He will not violate a person's free will. Now, Arminianism, and this goes back to the early church days, you know. This is Augustine. This is a man named Pelagius. Okay, early days of Christianity. Pelagius said that, no, because, you know, you say we're just chosen no matter what, you know, it has nothing to do with the way that we behave, has nothing to do with our actions, has nothing to do with our righteousness and our holiness. So you're saying that people who live like the devil are going to go to heaven. Because it doesn't matter. God chose them. So it doesn't matter how they live. He says, I say, you've got to live a certain way. That it is the combination of how does he put it? Let's see if I can find it. It is a combination of faith and obedience that saves us. Okay? Well, it's not entirely with faith. Obedience plays a part in this. In our sanctification. But Pelagius said that our obedience played a part in this. That we had to be obedient because when we were disobedient, we were no longer saved. That our salvation hung on our ability to be faithful. I don't mean faith in God. I mean faithful in our conduct. So that the guy who committed a sin is no longer saved. Now, this...
That's a Pentecostal thing.
Well, it's Arminian. This is what's called Arminian. Because a man named Jacob Arminius was responding to Calvinism. And then the Calvinists responded back to Arminius with the 5 points of Calvinism. Now, it is my personal belief that, like I said, well, that time they didn't leave much room between the two. There is a chasm of levels of where people are, and I believe that the reality lies between, because it does fall to the point of sovereignty of God, free will of man is what it comes down to. You know? And, you know, and then we have verses. Okay, turn to Matthew 18. to look at a couple of verses just to show you that this is sort of the part of Scripture that we find puzzling and maybe even a little frustrating.
Chapter 18,
Matthew 18, in verse 7. Woe to the world because of offenses, for offenses must come. Sovereignty of God. God is saying, there will be offenses. Okay? But woe to that man by whom the offenses come. Responsibility of man. So, God is in control, but that doesn't negate man's responsibility. Now, does that mean that God authored that sin? No. You know, again, we go back to this idea of foreknowledge. You know, foreknowledge precedes election. And God's foreknowledge is different than our foreknowledge. We think of foreknowledge as like clairvoyance. Well, I know what's going to happen in the future. Well, God knowing what's going to happen is more than just knowledge. It also has to do with how he deals with us. Because God knowing how we will respond affects how he deals with us before that time comes. Now, does that mean that he ordained the end result? No, but he ordained some of the things that happened in the process up to the point, but just prior to the point of dealing, of offending our free will. Philippians 2.
You turn there. Or...
Philippians 2, 12 to 13. Just do 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, free will of man. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Sovereignty of God. Okay, Acts chapter 2. In verse 23, this is Peter's Pentecost, you know, day of Pentecost message. Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands and have crucified and put to death. Sovereignty of God, free will of man. You know, God says, this is going to happen, but you're the one that's going to choose to do it. And you're still going to be held accountable. So there is this balance between the two that creates this friction with all of this. Because God says you are elected beforehand. But it's not that he chose capriciously, I appoint these people into heaven, I appoint these people unto hell. He chooses those whom he foreknew would respond to his initiations. You know, God's choice. Sometimes it's hard for our brain to get to really wrap around this. But God's choice is not dependent on our free will, but it is related to it. Because he is going to choose, because again, he doesn't have to choose. Our salvation is based on his choosing us. But his choosing us is based on his foreknowledge of our response to his initiations. So it always starts with God. And it does get, you're going to start following this around and go, wait a minute, I lost you. But it always starts with God. And the whole process is all God. Our salvation, our sanctification, and our glorification. All three parts of our salvation are all totally of God. You know, we cannot, you know, we're not here yet. So we don't have any reference for glorification. But we're walking in this right now. We're walking in our sanctification. If we've done it for any length of time, we know that we can't do it. I mean, I had a guy one time I was sharing the gospel with him. He says, yeah, I was a Christian once. I just couldn't do it. I tried and I tried and I tried and I just couldn't do it. I didn't have it in me to be a Christian. I'm like, well, you were doing it wrong. You know, because, yeah, no kidding, you can't do it. You can't, you know, you can't fix yourself. It has to come from God. It has to come from you depending upon God.
So can I ask?
Sure.
Regardless of his believing he might be saved, he was never saved.
You got to go there, huh? Okay. I'm going to give you the Chuck Smith take on all that.
Could you just repeat the question?
Well, he was talking about, basically, you're saying, and correct me if I'm wrong, you're sort of trying to figure the differentiation between whether somebody like that guy I was talking to, was it that he was never saved, or was he saved once? Is that kind of like where you were going with that?
The way I spoke about it in the past, to others, is that once saved, always saved, provided you're saved in God's mind, not your own mind.
Yeah. And I think that's, well, here's the thing, I'll hit this very quickly, because there's two points of view with both of these. Once saved, always saved, which I don't like, again, it's all terminology. I don't like the terminology, once saved, always saved, because, like you said, what does that mean? Because I said a prayer? Because I went to a Billy Graham crusade and I had an emotional response? You know, what does that really mean? Once saved, always saved. Then over here, you can lose your salvation. Well, I don't like that line either. Because my salvation is not in my own hands, it's in God's hands. Chuck Smith's point of view is this whole issue of eternal security. You know, Chuck Smith's response is just abide in Christ. That's it. You abide in Christ. Because here's the thing, it's not my job to decide whether or not you're saved. Whether you were ever saved, or whether you lost your salvation, or whether you misplaced your salvation, or however you people want to word it. It's none of my business. My concern about eternal security is about my own eternal security. And eternal security is has to do with my security, my understanding that I am saved. Now, if I am living in sin, if I am not abiding in Christ, now when I say living in sin, I don't mean struggling with sin. I mean, like I said, you know, a couple weeks ago, laying in the hammock of sin. I'm loving it. Don't tell me I'm wrong, because this is the way I want to live my life. If that's the way I'm living, I have no reason to believe that I'm saved. I cannot have eternal security. Even if I say, well, I said a prayer. Well, good for you. Where is it? Like James said, you know, can faith alone save you? If, you know, you show me faith, I show you works. Not that the works save me, but the works are going to be the demonstration of my salvation. If I'm laying in the hammock of sin and I have nothing to show for my salvation, I have no reason to believe that I'm saved. That's why Chuck Smith says, well, just abide in Christ. Am I abiding in Christ? If I'm sitting there wondering, am I saved? Am I saved? Well, am I abiding in Christ? Am I walking every day seeking after Christ?
Are you being obedient?
Are you being convicted of your sin? Exactly. And it points out the difference that you know right. The Holy Spirit. And that's the key. If I'm laying in sin and I'm loving every minute of it, what happened to the Holy Spirit? Did he go on vacation? You know, if I'm a believer and I'm living in sin, the Holy Spirit should be ripping me apart on the inside. And I should be knowing it. Now, we can struggle with sin. We can fall back in sin. But, you know, there are guys who have been out there soul winning and whatever, and now they say, I don't even believe in God anymore. I don't believe that stuff. I used to believe that stuff when I was a kid. I don't believe it anymore. Okay, don't tell me that guy's saved. God's not going to save somebody against their will. I don't believe it. I don't want any of that. I reject it. What was it? Sam Kinison. Anybody remember Sam Kinison?
Yeah.
He was that comedian that all he did was scream all the time.
Yeah.
And he was raised, he was a preacher. And now he turned and said, I don't believe that stuff anymore. That stuff is for kids, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, he ended up being killed. But the thing is, don't tell me that guy's going to heaven. Because he once said he believed, or he said, now does that mean he never was saved? Or does that mean he lost his salvation? I don't know. I don't care. It's not any of my business. I can only look at the fruit. You know? I can only look at what is going on in that guy's life. More importantly, I have to look at what's going on in my life. Is there fruit in my life? Am I seeking after God? And again, I don't mean struggling with sin, because we struggle with sin. Conviction is a great testimony to my own salvation, that the Holy Spirit is convicting me of my sin. You know, somebody has said, how do I know if this guy's been living in, you know, blah, 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 blah. How do I know if he's saved? How's his life right now? Oh, it's great. Everything's going great. Well, put two and two together. They said, God, oh, his life is falling apart. Everything's going on. He lost his house. He lost this. His wife left him. Okay, maybe God's doing something with him to try to get him back.
Yeah. To me, Rick, it's a direction or a bent. I like to think of it as a Christian is a follower.
Mm-hmm.
You are following the Holy Spirit, and
yep.
You are, your direction, your travel, your destination, your goal is to be a Christian and follow Christ and be
yep.
closer to Him. That is a believer walking obedience. If you're going the other way, and none of those things are true of you, you have to almost stop and think, you know, well, maybe I'm not.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't feel comfortable with this.
Right, and that's why I love the simplicity of Chuck Smith's answer. And this was his pat answer. When anybody, we had a kid come here who was friends of James out in Bible college, and he was talking about, you know, he was in Bible college, he was out there when Chuck was still alive, and there was a bunch of them all around, you know, and Chuck, and this is toward the end of his life, he was 83, 84 years old, and, you know, all these young Bible college students, and they're all around Chuck Smith, and they said, okay, Chuck, once and for all, can you lose your salvation? And he goes, just abide in Christ. And he walked away. You know, it's like, that's where you should focus your attention. That other stuff is about arguments.
He used to say regarding Calvinism and Arminianism, truth is in the middle.
Yeah,
exactly. His favorite
that's what I say. That's where the truth lies. And all the other stuff is about winning an argument. It's not about seeking truth. It's really just about winning some kind of an intellectual or theological argument. Because just worry about your own salvation. Worry about, where am I with Christ? Am I abiding in Christ? Because if I am abiding in Christ, then I have eternal security. Then I know that I'm saved. You know, and we can argue, was he ever? Did he lose it? Who cares? Abide in Christ. Hang on, one second.
Goes along with what you were saying, abiding in Christ. If we accept it and we believe that we're saved, but the only sin that isn't forgivable is when we reject what He did for us.
Right, that's the interesting point, because you can go both ways. It's like, well, the one sin is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. So if I turn around, and I'm not talking about just that it's the sin that can do something, but if I turn around and I am now rejecting Christ, I am blaspheming the Holy Spirit by rejecting Christ, I have no reason to believe that I'm saved. You know? Does that mean I stepped away from my salvation? Or does it mean I never was? Whatever. I don't know. It doesn't really matter. It's not the point. You know, the point is that condition right there is not the condition of a saved person. And that's the you know, the crux of the matter, all this other stuff just becomes about arguing.
Pastor once told me, years I was going through this, am I really saved or not type mm-hmm. period of my life. And Pastor once told me, did you ever worry about being saved when you weren't saved?
Yeah.
And I said, no. Because the fact that you're worried about it means you are saved.
I think that's a great way to look at it. Never had that struggle in my life before I was saved, right?
Yeah, I never struggled, but you know, all of a sudden, the guy told me that and I felt like,
because if it's important,
years ago.
Because if you don't care, you're probably not. You know, if it matters to you,
never worried about
then
that
you
before.
Are. Yeah. So that's where I'll go with that. I'll kind of leave it there. Any questions before we close? But
we will just put up our saved by your grace. Which is Titus 2:11 and
mm-hmm.
Ephesians 2:8.
Mm-hmm.
And the Holy Spirit also, He teaches us, He instructs us, He guides us also. If we read in Psalms 32:8, He instruct us, he guide us, he direct us what to do. So always, when we are saved by grace, after grace also it follows instruction. What does God need from me? He tells us everything. So God is always with us, no matter what, as long as we obey and follow his rule and regulations.
Yep, there was, I'm gonna try to find this one quote that I saw. Was it in this one?
Okay, Rick, can I read this?
Sure.
1 John 2. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin, but anyone sin, he does not know God. And then we know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. The man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not him, in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did.
Yep. There it is. Yeah. And just to what Bahani was saying, you know, the Christian worldview is that God exists, he is the creator. Because he made us, he is sovereign. If you can make something, then you have rule over it. As sovereign, he has the right to tell us what to do. You know, that's why he gave us the law. Not to boss us around, but because he's, I made you. As your sovereign, as your creator, I want what's best for you. You know, and the same could be said of you know, children, until they reach the age of majority. It's like, you know, what was that one line the comedian said, look, I brought you in this world, I'll take you out. You know, look, you're under this roof. You are my child. I brought you into this world. I'm responsible for you. I'm going to tell you what to do. I'm going to tell you what's best for you, and I expect you to do those things. You know, and it sounds harsh. It sounds harsh because we're adults and we think, you be telling me what to do. Well, he's God. He's not just some, you know, he's not the president. He's not the king. He's God. And if he says, if I made you, and I'm your sovereign, and I love you, then I have the right to tell you what to do. The greatest form of government ever is a benevolent dictatorship. Now, that cannot exist with men. We don't, because power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So when somebody becomes dictator, they automatically start looking out for their own best interest and not for the people's best interest. A benevolent dictator is somebody who only does what's best for the people. He's not concerned for himself. Well, God is a benevolent dictator. He wants us to do what he tells us to do because it's what's best for us. You know, and that's where, you know, when you look at works and all that stuff, it's not a matter of earning his favor. It's a matter of just being obedient to the one who loves us. You know, and that, you know, grace is given as the gift, and grace is still the process by which we are sanctified. But he has given us, that's why, you know, we should love the law. The law is good for us.
Absolutely.
You know, and we just have to learn to apply it in a grace situation and not do it in a sense, well, if I do this, you're going to be happy with me, God? No, I'm not. If you do it in that heart, then with that attitude, I definitely won't be happy with you. Do it with a heart of faith, and that is what pleases God.
Paul tells us in Romans 14, 7 and 8, if I live, I live for Christ. If I die, I die for Christ. So to us, we are sold out. Once we believe Jesus Christ, the body doesn't belong to us. It belongs to God. So God, he tells us what to do. That's the way we need to understand. Because the way we are living now, we are living for him. And we are waiting for him. So it's good to understand and read the word of God. ABC.
Yeah, that's it. That's what keeps us in the mind of Christ. Alright, so next week, ecclesiology. We're going to look at the church defined, three pictures of the church, membership requirements. That's a little interesting thing since we don't have a membership. We'll get into that. Purpose of the church, government, offices and officers, ordinances, and the gifts of the Spirit. And gifts of the Spirit seems like it should go with pneumatology, but I put it here. Because this is where the gifts of the Spirit, the church is where the gifts of the Spirit are to be exercised. So it's about application. And that's what ecclesiology is, about taking all of this and applying it. This is where our salvation is lived out. You know, I mean, we work it out in the world, but this is where this process takes place, is in the Church of Christ, the body of Christ.
Is the Resurrection Day or Holy Week, is that going to interfere with this class at all?
No. I decided not to, especially since we already missed a class. Because it's the Monday after Easter, so, I mean, I don't know. Does anybody have something big or special or weird thing going on? Yet. You know, I think most people, the Monday after Easter is not necessarily any kind of a thing, you know. But unless I know some people are going away.
Isn't there something before Easter Monday? I still recall that when I was in
Monday. Monday, Thursday. And, yeah, which is the day before Good Friday. Let's go on this day. So that's going to be next week. Then after that, we get eschatology, and then we are done. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for this class and for the truths that you revealed to us. Help us to truly grasp the riches of your salvation and the riches of your grace that we know we won't fully grasp until we are in your presence. But help us to just draw nearer each day as we come to know you. So bless us now as we go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.